This is a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting.
And welcome to SDPB's live coverage of the 2021 State of the State Address. I'm Jackie Hendry, joining you from our studio in Vermilion. SDPB's Lee Strubinger is in the State Capitol building in Pierre. We'll join him to hear reactions from lawmakers after the address. Today marks the first day of the 96th state legislative session. The session runs through March 11th. This is Governor Noem's third State of the State address. This one, of course, follows a very difficult year. The governor announced the first COVID-19 cases in South Dakota on March 10th last year at the tail end of the 2020 legislative session. COVID recovery is expected to be one of the major issues facing lawmakers this year. And now we're going to take you live to the House chamber in the Capitol building in Pierre.
Wink, St. John, Deutsch, Goodwin, St. John, Mr. Speaker, all members have voted.
Please display the vote.
Mr. Speaker, there were 69 yeas, one excused.
That motion, having received the majority vote of the members elect, is hereby declared passed. There being no objection, we will revert to order of business number 4, communications and petitions.
Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that the governor has been notified that the legislature is duly organized and ready to meet in joint session to receive any communications she may desire to transmit, and that the governor is ready to appear before the joint session to deliver her message. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that arrangements have been made for a joint session of the Senate and the House of Representatives to receive the message of the governor, and that the Senate and the House will convene in joint session in the chamber of the House of Representatives at 1 p.m. January 12, 2021. That the President of the Senate preside over the joint session, and that the Secretary of the Senate and the Chief Clerk of the House of Representatives act as clerks of the joint session. That the justices of the Supreme Court and the elective and appointed officials of the state government be invited to attend the joint session. That when the message of the governor has been received, the joint session be dissolved. That the message of the governor be printed in the Senate Journal. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee of Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that arrangements have been made for a joint session of the Senate and the House of Representatives to receive a message of the Chief Justice of the Supreme Court. That the Senate and House convene in joint session in the chamber of the House of Representatives at 1:30 p.m., January 13, 2021. That the President of the Senate preside over the joint session, and that the Secretary of the Senate and the Chief Clerk of the House of Representatives act as the clerks of the joint session. That the justices of the Supreme Court, the governor, and elective and appointed officials of the state government be invited to attend the joint session. That when the message of the Chief Justice has been received, the joint session be dissolved. That the message of the Chief Justice be printed in the Senate Journal. Also, Mr. Speaker, the Committee on Legislative Procedure respectfully reports that arrangements have been made for a joint session of the Senate and House of Representatives to receive the message of the State of the Tribes from a tribal chairman, and that the Senate and the House convene in joint session in the chamber of the House of Representatives at 1:30 p.m., January 14, 2021. That the President of the Senate preside over the joint session, and that the Secretary of the Senate and the Chief Clerk of the House of Representatives act as clerks of the joint session. That the that the justices of the Supreme Court, the governor, and the elected and appointed officials of state government be invited to attend the joint session. That when the message of the tribal chairman have been received, the joint session be dissolved. That the message of the tribal chairman be printed in the Senate Journal.
Okay, now crank the wheel. Go ahead.
The speaker at this time will waive the reading of the committee assignments. There being no objection, the House will proceed on to order of business number 10, first reading of House bills.
Statutory cross-reference regarding insurance.
We have a constitutional obligation for those of you that are new to this process to read House bills twice. Due to the invention of electricity and the electronic age, we no longer have the necessity to do that, and that is why you're seeing these members actually physically read. Even though we cannot understand them, they are fulfilling the constitutional obligation for two readings on the House of Representatives. The speaker assigns House Bill 1027, 1028, 1029, 1034, 1035, 1036, 1040, and 1042 to House Ag and Natural Resources. The speaker assigns House Bill 1001, 1002, 1003, 1009, 1010, 1011, 1014, 1015, 1016, and 1037 to House Commerce and Energy. The speaker assigns House Bill 1013, 1017 to House Committee on Appropriations. The speaker assigns House Bill 1025, 1044 to House Education. 1004, 1005, 1006, and House Bill 1041 to House Health and Human Services. House Bill 1043 to House Judiciary. House Bill 1007, 1008, and 1045 to House Government, Local Government. House Bill 1031, 1032, and 1033 to House Retirement Laws. House Bill 1046 to House State Affairs. House Bill 1022, 1023, and 1024 to House Taxation. And House Bill 1012 to House Transportation. Are there any announcements? Representative Reimer.
I move. We adjourn.
Representative Reimer's motion that we adjourn, that having been made and seconded, this is non-debatable. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
All those opposed nay.
Nay.
We are adjourned.
Toes, like I'm her in heels. I need her not. This is not centered.
Okay, let's center it.
That's right.
Are we good to go?
Yeah.
I did. Joint session of the House and Senate will come to order. Giving the prayer today is Reverend Craig Wexler of the Pier Fort Pier Ministerial Association, and I will lead us in the pledge.
As your chief chaplain, I've always been tasked with scheduling all of us to pray, but in the times that we live in, I will also say that I'm also the neighbor next door at Luther Memorial. Genuinely, if any of you need a pastor while you're here, knock on the door. We're always there. We begin with a brief reading of Scripture. 1 Samuel chapter 8. So all the elders of Israel gathered together and came to Samuel at Ramah. They said to him, "You are old, and your sons do not follow your ways, Samuel. Now appoint a king to lead us, such as all the other nations have." But when they said, "Give us a king to lead us," this displeased Samuel, so he prayed to the Lord. And the Lord told him, "Listen to all that the people are saying to you. It is not you that they have rejected, but they have rejected me as their king. As they have done from the day I brought them out of Egypt until this day, forsaking me and serving other gods, so they are doing to you. Now listen to them. But warn them solemnly and let them know what the king who will reign over them will claim as his rights." Let us pray. Almighty God, today we are reminded of our state motto, "Under God, the people rule." May this be so. With all the guidance, with all the technology at our fingertips, I have prayed that one day we might actually learn from our mistakes. We might learn from our past. Samuel spoke to the people of Israel, praying that they would rule as people, trusting God instead of creating their own idols to trust. On this day, Lord, we ask the question, are we any different? Remind us today, O Lord, who it is that we are and what we are called. First and foremost, you have named us and claimed us to be yours. Our primary identity as your creation is the name Child of God. Secondly, as Americans and as South Dakotans, we also proclaim that we are called democracy, not Republican, not Democrat, not independent. No matter our race, no matter our gender, no matter our wealth, no matter our heritage, no matter our political party, every one of us in this room has taken the same oath, an oath to uphold the Constitution, but most importantly, the faithful oath of loving God and loving our neighbors. Reconcile us, O Lord. Forgive us, O God. Remind us of what we have been called and elected to do in a Christian faithful manner, which requires humility, community, and dignity in this space and in our home communities. In the best of times, but most importantly in the worst of times, times much like we are living in right now. I pray that we have not rejected you. I pray that we have learned from our Israelite ancestors. We do not need a king or idols. We need you and you alone. I pray that we will cling to your hope, your will, your promises, and your desires for the people of this great state in the weeks and months ahead. Bless our governor in her health and her family and her leadership. Bless everyone in this space, all of the representatives, the senators, and all of the support staff. Lord, God, help us. Amen.
I pledge allegiance. Secretary will call the roll. Secretary of the Senate will call the roll.
Senator Bolin, Breitling, Kamak, Castleberry, Crabtree, Curd, Diedrich, Duhamel, Duvall, Foster, Freimuller, Greenfield, Heinert, Hunoff, Jones, Johns, Johnson, Klum, Kolbeck, Maher, Nessebe, Nordstrup, Otten, Roll, Rush, Schoenbeck, Shane Fish, Smith, Stalzer, Steinhauer, Sutton, Simmons, Tobin, Wheeler, Wick, and Zickman. We have a quorum, Mr. President.
Thank you. The Chief Clerk will call the roll of the House.
Representatives Anderson, Allward, Bartles, Barthel, Beal, Blair, Bordeaux, Chafee, Chase, Schrock, Davis, Dennert, Derby, Deutsch, Drury, Duba, Fink, Fitzgerald, Goodwin, Gosch, Greenfield, Lana, Gross, Hansen, Haugard, Healy, Hoffman, Howard, Jameson, Jensen, Kevin, Jensen, Phil, Johnson, Chris, Carr, Kainz, Koth, Ladner, Lesmeister, Marty, May, Mills, Milstead, Miss Gimmons, Mortensen, Mullally, Odenbach, Olson, Otten, Ernie, Overweg, Perry, Peterson, Kent, Peterson, Sue, Pischke, Poyer, Randolph, Reed, Rayfelt, Reimer, Schneider, Smith, Jamie, Soy, St. John, Stevens, Thomason, Tiedemann, Vasgard, Weiss, Weisgram, Wiese, Willitson, Wink, York. Mr. President, there is a quorum.
Thank you. Madam Secretary.
Senator Kamak moves that a committee of three on the part of the Senate and a committee of four on the part of the House be appointed to escort the Honorable Kristi Noem, Governor of the State of South Dakota, to the rostrum.
Is there a second?
Second.
Any comments on that motion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Motion carries. The President announces the committee Senate members are Senators Schoenbeck, Kamak, and Heinert. House members are Representative Kent Peterson, Hansen, Smith, and Lesmeister. Well, today it's my distinct honor to introduce the governor, Governor Kristi Noem. Over the past several months, as the politicians in other states were implementing one-size-fits-all policies, Governor Noem took South Dakota down a unique path, and our state is in a tremendous position as a result. Governor Noem has bucked the status quo and rejected disastrous shutdowns. Instead, she chose to trust the people of South Dakota to make smart decisions for themselves. And she's been a tremendous ambassador to our state. Thanks to her unique leadership, countless new folks are moving to South Dakota. And they're moving here for the right reasons. They're moving here because they value the way of life we live. They appreciate the freedoms and personal responsibility, and they share our South Dakota values, and they want to share in our way of life as well. Over the past several months, I've had the opportunity to travel to all corners of our state, and South Dakotans have consistently asked me to thank Governor Noem for the actions she has taken. Today, she'll share with us how these actions have put our state in a strong position as we move forward. We are tremendously blessed to have her leading us through these unprecedented times. I have been honored to work alongside her to continue making South Dakota safer, stronger, and healthier. Sergeant Arms, would you please announce the arrival of our governor?
Ladies and gentlemen of this august body, would you please welcome the Honorable Governor Kristi Noem.
Seated. Well, Lieutenant Governor Roden, Mr. Speaker, members of the legislature, Chief Justice Jensen, and also justices of the Supreme Court, constitutional officers, and fellow South Dakotans, it is my privilege to stand before you today to discuss the state of our state. The year 2020 is one for the history books. We faced some incredible challenges in South Dakota. We met this adversity head on, and the people of South Dakota deserve all of the credit. Now, people struggled, they lost loved ones, and their livelihoods were threatened, but they never lost hope. They were resilient. Their fortitude enabled us to emerge from 2020 stronger as individuals and as a state. Now, last year, a good portion of the speech was dedicated to explaining why South Dakota is the perfect place to work and to run a business. Our people, our work ethic, and their values are second to none. Now, all of us in this room who work for them respect the rights of our people to live their lives. We don't have a corporate income tax. There is no business inventory tax. We have no personal income tax. And we also do not have a personal property tax or an inheritance tax. The taxes that we do have fund state government, and they are stable and they are predictable. In short, for those who might be worried about tax increases, you don't need to be. The government in South Dakota, we live within our means. We balance our budget without accounting gimmicks or tricks. We proudly hold a AAA credit rating, and our state pension plan is fully funded. Our state believes in smart regulation, and we roll out the red carpet, not the red tape. We are the pheasant capital of the world. And our state parks, yes, you can clap for that. And our state parks and our outdoor recreational opportunities are unmatched. For those who have spent the last 9 months shut down or locked up in other states, South Dakota is open. We have stayed open the entire time. And that is how we will operate for as long as I am governor. Now, one of my chief priorities as governor is to grow South Dakota. And that is why you hear me inviting those who cherish and value our way of life to come join us. South Dakota is the perfect place to come raise your family, to grow your business, and to live your life as you see fit. My administration continues to do everything in its power to help in this effort. This last year, we assisted with projects that will result in more than $2.8 billion in capital investment across South Dakota, projects ranging from agriculture to manufacturing to technology. We announced that Amazon is building a $200 million distribution center in Sioux Falls, but it wasn't just our largest community that saw this kind of success. Towns like Fort Pierre, Belle Fourche, Watertown, Rapid City, Parker and Lead all saw companies choosing and growing in their communities. In total, the projects that we have worked on over the past year are expected to result in more than 2,100 new jobs in the state of South Dakota. And just yesterday, we announced the largest project in the history of the Governor's Office of Economic Development, a $500 million investment from Schwann's, which will bring 600 full-time jobs to Sioux Falls. Now, CJ Foods and Schwann's are building a world-class facility, the most high-tech facility of its kind in the entire world. That's a great start to 2021 for our state. This economic development provides opportunities for our families and our communities to grow. It allows our kids to start and develop their careers here. And when they start their families, that will mean that they're closer to home, to mom, to dad, to grandparents, and to extended family. Strong families have always been the backbone of South Dakota. Now, President Reagan once said, "Our families nurture, preserve, and pass on to each succeeding generation the values that we share and we cherish, values that are the foundation of our freedoms. Today, more than ever, it is important that we strengthen families. I am committed to being a family-first governor, fighting to strengthen the family unit and preserve the values that South Dakotans have always long embraced. Now today I'm joined by two very special families that will help explain what one of my major priorities is this session, the Fite family and the Duffy family. Now Aaron and Tammy Fite live in Platte, South Dakota with their four children. Sean and Rachel Duffy live in Wisconsin. They have nine children, and you might remember that Sean served with me while I was in Congress. I have known both families for years, and the reason that I asked them to join us today is to highlight two of their children. Now, Cody Fite and Valentina Duffy both have Down syndrome. Now, God bless these beautiful children with an additional chromosome. Their gorgeous smiles, their distinct personalities, that vibrancy that you see, they're all gifts from God. For those who have had the privilege of knowing someone with Down syndrome, you know that that person ends up being a gift to all of us. So I share this today because even in 2021, in some European countries like Iceland and Denmark, they're on pace to virtually eliminate children with Down syndrome. They do this one way and through one way only, through abortion. As actress Patricia Heaton points out, Iceland is simply killing everyone that has it. Now, as South Dakotans, and frankly, as human beings, we should all be appalled by this. We are better than that. The Declaration of Independence summarizes what we all know in our hearts to be true, that God created each of us and endowed all of us with the right to life. This is true for everyone, including those with an extra chromosome. So I look forward to the day I look forward to the day when the Supreme Court recognizes that all preborn children inherently possess the right to life too. Until that time comes, I am asking that South Dakota and its legislature that will pass a law that bans the abortion of a preborn child just because that child is diagnosed with Down syndrome. Let's make South Dakota. Let's make South Dakota a symbol of hope and justice and love for children like Cody and Valentina. With the help of several pro-life groups across the state, my team will present legislation for your consideration and for swift passage. Aaron and Tammy, and Sean and Rachel, would you and your families please stand for us today? Thank you so much for being here, and thank you for being a voice for many of those who can't speak for themselves. Protecting children begins in the womb, but children of all ages need a loving family to care for and to support them throughout their lives. In my first state of the state, I stood at this podium and I asked people to open their hearts and their homes to foster children. I asked you to consider giving a child a forever home. In fiscal year 2020, we licensed a five-year high of 238 new foster homes. I want to commend those families that have opened up their hearts and their homes to these children. And let me explain to you why this work is so important. Oftentimes, these kids just need a bridge. They need someone to believe in them. It's important to note that there are a lot of people inside and outside of government providing that bridge. Today, I want to recognize a very special friend of mine, Jack. Jack is right back here at the back of the room. Would you stand up, Jack, while I talk about you? Jack Brewer, for those of you who might not know him, is a former NFL safety. Today, he's an ordained minister and the executive director of the Jack Brewer Foundation. He runs inner city youth programs and teaches in prisons all across America. He's an advocate for strong families, and he highlights the significance of having a father in every home. Now, Jack is in South Dakota this week to join the First Gentleman, to join Brian on a couple of visits to the men's and the women's prisons, as well as going to McGrossen Boys Ranch in Sioux Falls. Jack, I want to thank you for all the work that you do, all that you do here in the Crestwood. I'm excited about what Jack can teach all of us about being God's hands to people who need it. As I outlined in my budget address, I believe that we can create an environment where families are not forced to choose between the modern economy on the one hand and then life in their hometown on the other. And that's why I'm proposing that we invest in finishing connecting this state with broadband. Even the most remote communities across our state should be provided the tools that they need to be connected. Thriving communities from border to border will yield much better results for our state and our families rather than concentrated growth in just two big cities. So there are still 135,000 South Dakotans without high-speed broadband access that we need to meet those needs in the 21st century. A state investment coupled with industry funding and federal grants is enough to get the job done. Now, success would mean that our rural communities would have the opportunity to grow and that families would have the chance to stay home together. Take, for example, the story of Jeff Odell. Jeff works for one of the largest computer network infrastructure companies in the world. He grew up in Lemon, South Dakota. He went to junior high and high school in Aberdeen, and after attending 1 year of college at the School of Mines, Jeff left and made his way west. For 20 years, Jeff lived in sunny Southern California. But every summer for the last 10 years, he would come back to South Dakota. At first, his trips were just a week or two at a time, but then they started to get longer. In April of 2019, Jeff started building a home in Lemon. And when COVID hit, thanks to broadband access, Jeff was able to move back to Lemon full-time and to work remotely. Most of his work days are spent on video conference calls, but he says he doesn't mind at all because he is surrounded by open spaces, fresh air, and great people. His cousins and their kids live in Lemon, and his folks and sister are just 3 hours away in Aberdeen with another sister in Bismarck. Then there's also another woman that we talked to, her name's Stacy. Every day she enjoys a view of the Missouri River, and with her dog by her side, she works remotely. According to Stacy, having a strong broadband connection means that she can work where she wants to live instead of living where she has to work. Now, stories like Jeff and Stacy's are very common in South Dakota lately. People with big city salaries are moving to small town South Dakota. They enjoy the lower cost of living and they end up spending their money in our communities. They believe in the freedom also that South Dakota has to offer. My hope is that we can work together to get our state connected so we can set up this generation and the next for success no matter where they want to live. Now, speaking of where people want to live, residential home sales are up all across the state. And home construction in South Dakota is especially strong. New home construction in South Dakota is more than 1.5 times greater than the national average. And over the past 10 months, construction employment in South Dakota is up 10% over a year ago. Now, as I told you all last month, we're in a much stronger financial position than other states across the country. States that shut down their economies are now looking for tax increases or drastic spending cuts to make their ends meet. We made different choices than virtually every other state over the past year. And to be fair, I never once thought that the decisions that we were making in South Dakota during the pandemic would be unique. But other states based a lot of their decisions on fear and on emotion, and now they're seeing the results of that. In South Dakota, we do not make policy out of fear. We prepare for the worst, but we always remain optimistic that the best is yet to come. We continue to get good news about South Dakota's revenue situation. Ongoing general fund revenues are up tens of millions of dollars compared to late in the last fiscal year. A similar story can be found in the agricultural industry. The blizzards and the flooding of 2019 prevented nearly 4 million of our 19 million acres from being planted. The result was a 24% decrease in corn production and 36% loss in soybeans from 2018. But USDA is forecasting that corn production is going to grow by 31% from last year, with yields estimated to increase to record highs. Soybeans also had a banner year, with overall production forecasts to grow to 53%. So this is very good news, because our agricultural industry is critically important. Our farmers and our producers not only feed their families, they also serve as a catalyst for our economy. In July, the reforms that we made to standardize and to streamline the permitting process took place. The result is a more competitive and an attractive environment for ag business. To date, I am pleased to report that we had 23 new ag projects resulting in more than 320 new jobs across the state of South Dakota. But even with all this good news, we need to continue to bolster our largest industry. And that's why the ag investments I proposed in my budget address are so crucial. The meat processing grants, the investment in the Dakota Events Complex, the creation of a program to give farmers more opportunity to market South Dakota meat products, and the merger of the Departments of Agriculture and Diener II, each of these items will help reinvigorate our number one industry and all of the families that it serves for so many years to come. And as we look towards the year ahead, I'm also excited to report to you that there's a light at the end of the tunnel when it comes to our fight with COVID-19. Now, South Dakota is leading the nation in dispersing the COVID vaccine. In just over a month, tens of thousands of people across the state have received their first dose. Now, this is a testament to the incredible work that the team of the Department of Health and all of our medical professionals are doing. We should not be surprised. Our medical professionals stepped up in all kinds of unforeseen ways in 2020, and their stories deserve to be told. Take, for example, what has happened the last month or so in Wagner. Just before Christmas, the CEO of Wagner Community Memorial Hospital shared some really outstanding news about the work that his team has been doing. They used an outpatient, innovative COVID-19 therapy to treat patients, including 30 residents in the nursing home. In total, more than 80 patients ranging in age from 50 to 104 have received this treatment without having to take up any hospital beds. 78 of those 80 patients have recovered. Now, yes. There's a similar story that has taken place here in Pierre. Dr. Daryl Plumage normally works at the clinic here in town, but when COVID hit, he and his team turned their attention away from the clinic to acute COVID care, and that included the Adventera Pierre facility. Every single resident in the Adventera facility is considered high risk. Of the 53 residents, 52 tested positive for the virus after a staffer unknowingly brought it into the facility. But like so many other long-term care facilities, the residents weren't the only issue. Half of the staff tested positive as well. Now, at times, Dr. Plumage and his team ended up working around the clock. During one stretch, some staff worked 12-hour days for 22 days straight. Despite being understaffed and overworked, this team was determined to handle the acute care needs of these residents. Admitting 52 people to the hospital in Pierre would have overwhelmed that facility. So Dr. Plumage and his team treated them at Adventera. The expectation was that half of the students or half of the residents would not survive. That number ended up being far less because of the work of Dr. Plumage and his team. 70% of the Adventera residents recovered from the virus. Now these stories, are not unique to Pierre and Wagner. What these medical professionals have done over the last 9 months to battle this virus is nothing short of remarkable. So with us today are the Wagner Hospital CEO, Brian Slaba, is up here. Would you please stand? Dr. Plumage is here with some of his team members as well, if they would all stand. Would you please give them a round of applause for all of their efforts to the healthcare professionals? What you did, what your teams did, what all medical professionals have done across the state deserves recognition, and I want to thank you from the bottom of my heart. God bless you for your work. We also made sure that our approach to caring for South Dakotans was holistic, that we focused on physical well-being, but also on mental health. In February 2020, the Department of Health worked with several other groups to focus on suicide prevention this year. Our 605 Strong Initiative connected South Dakotans fighting mental health issues with trained crisis counselors. This initiative proved critical in the face of a global pandemic. In 2020, we have seen our suicides decline. Now, another tool. Another tool that we greatly expanded access to is telehealth. So since March, people have used text services like these more than 70,000 times in South Dakota's Medicaid program alone. This year, I'm going to ask you to support legislation to make these flexibilities permanent. In 2021, we should build on telehealth advancements and continue to find ways to remove government red tape in healthcare. And lastly, on healthcare, I want to provide an update on the state's work to curtail substance abuse. We know that drug and alcohol abuse can destroy a family. And even though this kind of challenge can happen anywhere, it really is happening a lot in key areas of our state, including our tribal communities. Earlier this year, the third annual State Tribal Meth Summit was held virtually in partnership with the Department of Tribal Relations and the Department of Social Services. These summits are a bedrock in bringing state and tribal health care providers and leaders together. The state stands ready to work with our tribes in all South Dakota communities to combat substance abuse. And as we look to improve the overall health and well-being of every South Dakotan, recreation is a key part of that conversation. This last year's social distancing created a great opportunity for South Dakotans to get outside. Nature and the outdoors provided our families an escape from the pandemic. Because South Dakotans and our state remained open and we didn't lock down, more Americans from out of state came to enjoy our natural spaces too. We had roughly 8 million visitors to our state parks, which was an increase of more than 30% from 2019. Custer State Park surpassed 2 million visits this year for the first time ever. We saw increases in youth and first-time hunters. We also sold a record number of licenses for youth-mentored hunting. We saw huge increases in youth combo licenses, as well as resident and non-resident fishing licenses. So getting our youth to put down the Xbox and to pick up the tackle box has been a priority of mine for many years. In March, we had a young lady named Savannah Hendricks, who's a junior high school student from Vivian, who had a great idea. And she's here with us today, if she would stand. With the goal of getting out in the field more with her family, Savannah created a petition urging the Game, Fish, and Parks Commission to extend the youth pheasant season from 5 to 9 days. At the May meeting, the commission adopted Savannah's proposal. It is my hope that more young people like Savannah will get involved. They'll find new ways to secure South Dakota's outdoor heritage for the next generation. So, Savannah, thank you for the work you did to make a difference for our youth and getting them outside. It's my hope that you and your story will serve as an example to all South Dakotans to get involved in our policy making. Thank you. So we're going to continue to find ways to create more hunting and fishing opportunities for our state for those that are young and old. This year, I'm asking the legislature to adopt simpler licensure requirements for kids under the age of 18. The goal is to get more people engaged at an early age so they continue those experiences long into their adulthood. This is one of the reasons why I have so heavily emphasized the importance of the bounty program. Over the last 2 years, nearly 4,300 people participated in the Nest Predator Bounty Program, many being youth and first-time trappers. They have removed roughly 81,000 nest predators. That's a great thing for our pheasant numbers, and we are just getting started. Anecdotally, everything that we have heard this year is that the pheasant numbers are through the roof. Long-time hunters say that they have never seen as many roosters as they did this year. So that's good news for our state, for our future, and to continue to get folks to come here, visit us, and help us kill our state bird. Now, hunters are not the only people who come to our state this year. As I mentioned, this was a challenging year for tourism, but South Dakota has outperformed almost every single other state in the country in this category. Our visitor inquiries have skyrocketed, and one thing is clear. Folks from all across the country want to visit South Dakota. In 2021, we are going to build on this momentum. We're going to ensure that we continue to grow. Our tourism department will be working on a new strategic plan to guide its overall efforts for the next several years to take advantage of the huge amount of interest that we have received. This includes enhancing our promotion of the state in new markets, and especially targeting key demographics that have an interest in our parks, our history, our culture, and our great outdoors. Given that three of our state's rodeos were recently chosen as the very best in the country by the National Finals Rodeo and the PRCA, we will also be improving our facilities for hosting equestrian and rodeo events. We know that our state has the potential to be the best place in the country for some of these events, and we want to capitalize on those opportunities in the years ahead. This complements the department's ongoing work with agritourism and the First Gentleman's Small Town Initiative to get visitors off the beaten path and experience all that South Dakota has to offer. Our tourism department continues to make steady progress working with tribal partners around the state. They lay the groundwork to enhance tribal tourism on our reservations. And every visitor that we welcome to our state has an impact that resonates. Their visits help support good jobs, lifelong careers for South Dakotans. Their spending benefits our small businesses, and the tax revenue that they generate goes right back into our communities, and it helps keep this state the best place to live in America. One of the main reasons our tourism numbers have been so strong this year is the resilience of our people and our small businesses. The South Dakotans who run these small businesses inspire all of us. And our businesses will have a better chance of success if South Dakota students have excellent educational opportunities. Everyone in this room knows that a good education starts in the home. It starts with strong families. We have decades of research that shows us that families are the most critical influence on a child's success in the classroom. COVID-19 underscored just how involved parents need to be in their children's day-to-day education. It's our duty to find innovative solutions that empower parents to set up their children for success. This includes improving civic education for our kids. Students should be taught our nation's history and all that makes America unique. They should see firsthand the importance of civic engagement, and they should have robust discussions in the classroom so they can develop critical thinking skills. Our young people need more experience engaging with elected officials and practicing the art of the debate. It is also our responsibility to show them how government works, and here's how. I have tasked my administration with creating instructional materials and classroom resources on America's founding, our nation's history, and the state's history. We must also do a better job educating teachers on these three subjects. Through all of this, our common mission and key objective needs to be explaining why the United States of America is the most special nation in the history of the world. With this knowledge as a foundational building block, every South Dakotan can then chart their own path to their future. Our technical colleges, our universities, all of our higher education opportunities give them an excellent chance. Now, South Dakota's technical colleges have received national awards, attention, and funding for the high-quality programs that they offer in key growing industries. All four of our tech schools are in the top 4% of the country for upward mobility. Students who graduate from our colleges are fully equipped for high-demand technical careers the moment that they receive their diplomas. A young woman named Vanessa is a student in the licensed practical nursing program at Southeast Technical College. She is a first-generation college student and an incredibly hard worker. Vanessa is set to graduate this spring and already has a job lined up here in the state. Our technical colleges are full of stories like Vanessa's, and South Dakota is investing in our students to expand these opportunities moving forward. Last week, we made an exciting announcement regarding the future of the Build Dakota Scholarship. Together, over the next 5 years, we will invest approximately $40 million to train students for high-demand career opportunities. We also announced the creation of the Premier Scholarship, a needs-based scholarship endowment for our state. Denny and the Premier Center have already delivered a check for $50 million and have pledged another $50 million going forward. I'm asking for your support in this, and they will match it with another $50 million in the future. This was one-time money that will be transformational in a gift to needs-based students to help them with their educations. The Premier Scholarship requires that students live and work in South Dakota for 3 years after graduation. Otherwise, the scholarship turns into a loan. The endowment for this critical scholarship fund needs $200 million to be self-sustaining into the future. Denny and Premier are getting us halfway there. Your action will get the fund to $150 million, and together we can get this done. In partnership with the Department of Labor, the Technical College System also launched the South Dakota Upskill Program this fall. This program supports workers dislocated by COVID-19. Upskill consists of 22 online certificate programs in high-demand fields, including business, healthcare, information technology, and manufacturing. More than 100 individuals are taking advantage of this assistance. Workforce development remains a top concern for South Dakota companies, and some businesses are tackling this concern by building their own registered apprenticeship programs. In fact, 44 organizations have built registered apprenticeship programs since 2018. More than 700 South Dakotans are improving their skills through one of these programs. For example, in Huron, the executive director of Independent Health Solutions built a home health aide registered apprenticeship program. This structured training and mentorship improved their team morale and their confidence. It led to less than 1% turnover, and it allowed for a 20% increase in the number of home health aides that were on staff. While registered apprenticeships are just one solution to workforce development, it lays a strong foundation for our future workforce and for our state economy. And now I want to turn to a subject that we all hold dear to our hearts. It is our veterans and our military. This year, South Dakota was ranked number one state in America for veterans to live and to work. We have expanded the tuition program for veterans to include technical colleges. We've increased property tax exemptions for veterans who have disabilities. We have a tax exemption for paraplegic and amputee veterans. We have increased the number of beds at the Hot Springs Veterans Home so that we can take care of more veterans. We also broke ground on the first ever state veterans cemetery in Sioux Falls. These veterans are special members of our state, and they're like family to so many of us in our communities. I'd like to highlight a story to illustrate this point. Jerry Upsall is a veteran who served our country in the United States Air Force. Today, she is the Sisseton Wahpeton Oyate Tribal Veterans Service Officer and works with the Department of Veterans Affairs. It is her love of country that guided her to continue down the path of serving our heroes. Now, Jerry has a sincere drive and passion to serve veterans. This year, Jerry was awarded the South Dakota Department of Veterans Affairs Outreach Officer of the Year Award. And Jerry is with us today. Would you please join me in thanking her for her service to our nation and all the veterans across our state? Another group of men and women who deserve our recognition are the members of the South Dakota National Guard. The Guard's response to the pandemic is now the longest sustained state-supported mission in the history of the Guard. Our soldiers and airmen have provided COVID-19 support since March. Now, our Guard's support for federal commitments also continued in 2020. South Dakota committed roughly 490 soldiers and airmen from 5 units to stateside missions or overseas contingency operations. But there is one battalion and their commander who I would like to single out today. Lieutenant Colonel Dave Moore commanded the Guard's 152nd Combat Sustainment Support Battalion. Under his command, and for the second time in 3 years, the peer-based 152nd was recognized as the most outstanding Army National Guard battalion in America. On behalf of the unit, Lieutenant Colonel Dave Moore says this, "It is an incredible honor to receive these awards, and that their selection is a testament to the professionalism and the dedication of all the 152nd soldiers and a validation of all the hard work that they put in. Collectively, the 152nd has received 13 Bronze Stars, 50 Army Accommodation Medals, 20 Army Achievement Medals, and 67 Combat Action Badges, Would you all please join me, and I'm asking them to stand so you can applaud them, Lieutenant Colonel Moore, the 152nd Unit, and the entire South Dakota National Guard for their commitment to service, sacrifice, and to the great state of South Dakota. Please stand. The folks serving at Ellsworth Air Force Base also deserve our recognition. We're joined today by Airman First Class Emily Campos. Would you stand, Emily? Emily was born and raised in Box Elder. She and her six siblings were raised by a single working mom. After graduating from Black Hills State, Emily joined the Air Force and became a radiology tech. She was named Distinguished Graduate of her class. She then completed specialized radiology training at the Air Force Academy, where she was recognized by the 10th Surgical Squadron Commander for her academic achievements. Now, Airman Campos relocated to Ellsworth Air Force Base in August. In her role, she serves the base's 17,000 active duty military personnel, military dependents, and retiree beneficiary population. She also volunteered to help with the base's COVID response training. Her efforts directly contributed to the protection of military personnel in support of two bomber task force missions to the Indo-Pacific Theater. Emily, we want to thank you, and from the bottom of our hearts, recognize you for all your efforts and the efforts on behalf of your fellow airmen and airwomen. Our state is incredibly grateful for your work, their work, and all of your service to our nation. The work that Emily and all those do at all those who serve at Ellsworth Air Force Base is so crucial to our national defense. This year in my budget, I asked you to fund the Liberty Wellness Center project. I hope you will support it for Ellsworth and for the surrounding community. Now, last year, we started the Governor's Heroism Award to honor heroes who risk their lives to save the life of another. And I would like to talk to you now about this year's honoree. Joining us today is the family of Chief Deputy Lee Weber of the Hughes County Sheriff's Department. Now, Chief Deputy Weber had served in the department since 2015. Before that, he enlisted in the U.S. Army soon after 9/11 and completed two tours to the Middle East in service to our great country. He was active in the Army National Guard. He loved hunting and fishing, watching football, and spending time with his wife, Wendy, and their six children, who he loved deeply. This past July 3rd, Lee was boating with his family on the Missouri River. His son fell out of the boat with no life vest on. And without hesitation, Lee dove into the water to save his son. And while he was able to get to his son safely, Lee was not able to save himself. He died a hero that day. So we mourn the loss of this great man, and we honor Lee for his courage, his sacrifice, and his selfless commitment to you and to your family, Wendy. I want to extend my prayers and my condolences to you and to your entire family. Their family's sitting right up here, and Wendy, if you and the family don't mind standing. Today, given Lee's selfless courage and sacrifice, I am awarding the Governor's Award for Heroism to your husband, Chief Deputy Lee Weber. Thank you. Strengthening families, no matter what they look like, is a key element to every decision that I make as governor, and I am committed to keeping family at the center of my policy decisions. The family is the cradle of civil society. Strong families create strong communities, and strong communities will produce the strongest state in the nation. This session, I hope you all will join me in standing up for families. Last year, we found so many ways to work together to maintain the freedoms of our people, to promote our outdoor heritage, to rein in the endless expansion of government into our daily lives. This year, it is my hope that we will find even more opportunities to work together, advancing common sense solutions to the problems that we can solve on behalf of the people of this great state. Now, before I close, I want to take a moment to thank my family. Brian and Cassidy and Kyle are back there today. Kennedy and Booker are at school. But I want to thank you all for your love and for your support and for your energy. People who know our family know that we do this job together. Every challenging time, they walk alongside me, they support me, they pray with me, and they help me make wise decisions for people. Because of them and their support for me and doing this job and serving South Dakota together, we are hoping that every decision we make is it makes South Dakota a better place to be, a better place to live, to do business, to raise a family. One of the reasons that I care so deeply about all of these issues is because I want those things for my family and for every other family. And I know that's why all of you serve as well. So I look forward to working with each of you and with all of South Dakota's leaders to improve our state for today and for the next generation. Thank you, and may God bless the great state of South Dakota.
That closes Governor Kristi Noem's third State of the State address. A lot of topics covered, outlining some of her priorities for the upcoming legislative session. The first she mentioned, asking the legislature to come up with a ban on abortions specifically for based on diagnosis of Down syndrome. The first priority mentioned, also a lot of others discussed, completing the broadband funding statewide, permanent flexibilities for telehealth after watching the benefits of those during the pandemic, simpler licensing requirements for hunting and fishing for people under age 18. Also interesting, the governor has asked her administration to craft civic education curriculum and classroom aids to deal with the country's history and things like this. It's a little unclear, based just on the speech, if there's a legislative angle, some bill that will be introduced, or if that curriculum is going to be developed and heard mainly in State Board of Education meetings. That board next meets on the 19th, so we'll continue coverage on that as we find out more details. But a lengthy speech with a lot of priorities, discussion of recovery from COVID-19, how certain hospitals responded to that. Not a lot of conversation about remaining funds from the federal government related to COVID-19 aid. So those are some of the highlights from the governor's State of the State speech. We're waiting to join SDPB's politics and public policy reporter, Lee Strubinger. He's rounding up his lineup of guests on the House floor. We'll hear from legislative leadership from both the Senate and the House to get some of their reactions to the governor's speech, their thoughts on her priorities. You can continue following us on Twitter. You can find us at SDPB News with live tweets of the address. If you're just now joining us, you can find a nice lineup of a summary there. You can also watch our ongoing coverage online, sdpb.org/statehouse. We'll be having a roundup of newscast material from our State of the State coverage today, later this afternoon. You can also listen on SDPB radio for some of those stories as well. We're going to toss live now to Lee Strubinger with his first guest. Lee, take it away.
Troy Heiner, he's a Democrat from Mission, representing District 26. What did you make of the governor's State of the State address today?
You know, I thought there were some things in the State of the State address that we can agree with. Obviously, there's some things in there that we won't. We're just going to have to get with our colleagues and see where everything lands.
What are some of those things that Democrats might not agree with that was outlined today?
You know, I think the merger between Ag and DENR, I'm not sold on that idea yet. We're going to look at some of her other legislative priorities that she brought up and, you know, see if they meet our priorities and the people of South Dakota's.
One of those priorities that she's talked about today and also during the budget address was the $100 million broadband expansion. Is that something that Democrats are behind?
You know, we've looked at that, and broadband is going to be key in all corners of the state. I have already mentioned to her administration that, you know, there still needs to be some work done with tribal communities to make sure that we are covering everybody in the state. And then really allowing that access, whether that's an educational access, business access, to work for everyone.
Do you plan on bringing the Ochechi Shikoan Charter School bill this year? And what do you expect this time around?
So the Ochechi Shikoan community-based school will be, that legislation will be coming back. You know, I hope we have the same result in the Senate. You know, there's an education piece to that bill that needs worked on or with our House colleagues, so everybody understands what it's trying to do. So, you know, I'm hopeful for the legislation, and I'll be working with numerous people to try to get that passed.
Could you talk a little bit more about some other priorities that the Democrats have and things that you agreed with that the governor said today?
Sure. You know, as a caucus, we've talked about the enormous expense that families are going to incur from loved ones with COVID. And I didn't hear that in her speech at all. That is an issue that we need to address. You know, we surely don't want to break or bankrupt families because they contracted a disease. So we need to be looking at that. Some of the things that we do agree with the governor on are the scholarship program, the needs-based scholarship. You know, we have brought that legislation for years, and we hope it finally gets some support and passage.
Senator, thank you so much for your time today. I really appreciate it.
Yep. Thank you, Lee.
Back to you, Jackie.
Thanks, Lee. We'll come back to you once you get your next guest for us. So if you're just joining us, Lee Strubinger just spoke with Senator Troy Heinert of Mission, part of the Democratic leadership in the State House. Democrats, very few members, lost a few more seats in the most recent election to the point where not every legislative committee will have Democratic representation. So speaking to some of those points, some agreements, disagreements with the governor's priorities, Senator Heinert not sold on the merger between Ag and the Department of Environment and Natural Resources, does support the development of need-based scholarships. And it sounds like Lee does have our next guest. So Lee, I'll let you take it from here.
I'm standing here with Representative Kent Peterson. He's the new majority leader here in the House, representing District 19. He's from Salem, South Dakota. Representative, what did you make of the governor's speech today?
I thought it was very strong. She laid out a great plan for talking about people and families and some of the accomplishments we've had over the last few years, and I thought she did a great job.
I wanted to ask you and sort of maybe where House Republicans sit on the broadband initiative that she's been talking about.
$100 million is a lot of money.
Yeah, you know, we've been supportive of that in the past. Obviously, as we look into the budget this year, we're going to be very, not cautious, but look very strongly at that again. Broadband is something that can allow people to work from anywhere they want. And so I'm hopeful that we can be supportive of that, but we'll take a very strong caucus look at that and hopefully come out on the right side.
Obviously, we heard from the governor today and also during the budget address. What are some House Republican priorities heading into this session?
Sure. You know, we're working on that still, but obviously the governor's talked about infrastructure, taking care of families, a lot of the things she talked about today. We're going to keep working on those as we get going in session, but we're off to a great start.
During her speech, she had mentioned that her administration will be working with some pro-life groups to ban abortion on preborn children with Down syndrome. South Dakota is one of the more stricter states in the country when it comes to abortion law. What do you make of this legislation and what it will how it will impact the state?
I think it's fantastic. I think our House caucus is looking forward to looking at that legislation and making that become law in South Dakota, protecting the life of the preborn, no matter what conditions are coming with that. And so we're very excited about that, and I look forward to having that discussion.
She also mentioned some curriculum that her administration might be rolling out to send to schools, more civics-based education. She has brought that up before. Do you think this year will be the year for that, and what do you think it'll look like?
Yeah, you know, I haven't seen the legislation yet, but I have heard a little bit about it talking in the speech today. You know, I think we took a run at it a couple years ago, and as she said, it wasn't quite right. And I hope that this is something that we can really take a good look at and get it implemented. I think civics and the history of not only the United States, but the history of South Dakota is something that's important to all of us, and we need to make sure it's taught in the correct way.
One more question for you. You know, one of the big storylines this session is going to be the surplus, and that always ends up getting debated up until literally the last hour of session. How do you see that kind of playing out this year?
I think, you know, the governor laid out her budget request a month ago, and it's going to come right down to it. I think, you know, there's lots of ideas floating out there. Obviously, she has her ideas. The Senate's going to have their ideas, and the House will have their ideas. And as you know, a lot of those decisions are worked on all session but are finalized that last week. And I see this being no different. We've had lots of requests from lots of people looking to use these one-time dollars. And our objective is to find things that we can leverage and create to make things last for the future. And I think we're going to try to do that as best we can.
Representative, thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you.
Back to you, Jackie.
Thanks, Lee. If you're just joining us, Lee was just talking with Representative Kent Peterson, the new majority leader in the South Dakota House of Representatives, from Salem, supporting Governor Noem's State of the State address, calling it a strong message and a great plan with accomplishments that he agrees with, strong support for the governor's proposed ban on abortions based on a Down syndrome diagnosis, believes that there should be no problem pushing that through, especially in the his caucus. Not seeing the legislation yet as it refers to that civics education curriculum. We'll remember a couple years ago in a State of the State address, strong support, a standing ovation from lawmakers related to civics education for South Dakota students. And that message ultimately fell by the wayside. Nothing passed in that particular year. So it'll be interesting to see how lawmakers respond this year, assuming a bill is brought to committees. Also, discussion of the surplus. Every year seems to be a surplus. Everyone hoping for a few more dollars in their direction. Representative Kent Peterson saying it's going to be much the same this year, coming down to the wire on making some of those decisions. I'm going to toss it back to you, Lee, now. Who's your next guest?
She'll point at us when we're ready to go. I'm standing here with Representative Erin Healy. She's a Democrat from Sioux Falls, representing District 14, Democratic Whip. Representative Healy, what did you make of the governor's speech today?
Yeah, I thought it was really interesting. What I would have really appreciated hearing more about was the COVID efforts that our state needs to continue to address as we, make our way through this pandemic.
What are some of those things that you wanted to hear?
Yeah, well, you know what? I was very happy to hear about the vaccinations and how we are leading the nation in dispersing COVID vaccines. This is important considering that we are one of the highest COVID rates and also death rates in the nation. But it would have also been really nice to hear about how we need to listen more to our healthcare providers. The strengths of being able to disperse the COVID vaccination is because of our healthcare providers. And I wish we would have listened to them when we were discussing ways that we could mitigate efforts and keep people safe and have a lot of preventable deaths in our state.
Do Democrats have anything they want to push in terms of how to further address this pandemic?
You know, we are always open to ways as to how we can mitigate effort or how we can create mitigation efforts. I really hope that we can address the health and the prosperity and the safety of all South Dakotans living here in our great state.
One of the things I wanted to talk to you about as a Democrat who sits on House Education was about her civics education proposal that she had brought up again. She brought it up before. It didn't quite make it through. But what do you make of sort of her civics education proposal?
Yeah, well, I'm looking forward to seeing what it's about. It's so hard to really understand what that all entails without seeing a bill in front of us. I will work with her if it seems like a good bill that will teach our kids how to, properly have a good position in state government, in national government, and how can we have kids understand that facts and data and solid information is vital to a good and healthy democracy.
Another thing that Noem brought up during her speech today was she wants her administration to work with several pro-life groups to ban abortion for preborn children with Down syndrome. Mm-hmm. Could you talk a little bit about your reaction to that proposal?
Yeah, well, to me, this seems a little bit like a diversion away from the topic of COVID. If we want to focus on the sanctity of life, I think we need to spend more time discussing COVID and mitigation efforts and how we can prevent many deaths in the state of South Dakota.
Thank you so much for your time, Representative. I appreciate it.
Thank you for having me. Yes.
Jackie, back to you.
Thanks so much, Lee. If you're just joining us, Lee Strubinger just wrapping up with Representative Aaron Healy, a Democrat from the Sioux Falls area, reacting to the governor's State of the State address. Also commenting as one of the members of the House Education Committee, reacting to the governor's push for stronger civics education, saying it's hard to really know what that includes and how to react to it without having a bill in front of her, though she looks forward to seeing that. That's going to wrap up our live coverage of the State of the State address. Tomorrow, you can catch the State of the Judiciary. It's the first for the state Supreme Court's new Chief Justice, Stephen Jensen. And on Thursday, you'll watch the State of the Tribes address. We've not seen yet who's set to deliver that particular speech. You can watch both of those live online at sd.net. You can also find more coverage throughout the legislative session online at sdpb.org/statehouse. You can also follow us on Twitter at sdpbnews and with the hashtag SDLEG. Coming up next Thursday, you can join me live at 8 Central, 7 Mountain on SDPB-TV for this year's first State House edition of South Dakota Focus. On behalf of all of us here at South Dakota Public Broadcasting, thanks for watching.